Thank you. us bow our heads for the invocation. Eternal God, our Father, we come today in the name of Jesus with so much to be thankful for. But this is truly the day that you have made, and we're going to rejoice and be glad in it. We're going to rejoice because you have been the God of our weary years and the God of our silent tears and the one who has brought us thus far along the way. We're going to rejoice because of the cloud of witnesses that encompass us on this day, those who have brought Wilberforce University to this hallowed and sacred place. We say thank you to the Lord on this day for we rejoicing for the students and for the faculty and for the administration and for the distinguished visitors and guests who come from across this nation for this day of investiture. We want to say thank you, dear Lord, for all that you've done to bring us this far along the way. But most of all, dear Lord, on this day, we want to say thank you for the Reverend Dr. Floyd H. Flake. We want to say thank you that eyes could not have seen and ears could not have heard and his mind could not have comprehended in 1962 when he sat here as a freshman what you were getting ready to do. But oh Lord, we want to say thank you that you have brought him back to his native school for such a time as this. So now, dear Lord, grant him wisdom, grant him courage, grant him the faith of Bishop Daniel Alexander Payne for such a time as this. And we want to say thank you, dear Lord, that we stand in faith that the best is yet to come. Thank you for the woman of God that stands beside him, the Reverend Dr. Elaine Flake. We thank you for the Flake family. We thank you, dear Lord, for what you're getting ready to do. Bless Bishop Richard Allen Hildebrand as he preaches what thus saith the Lord, that we'll run on to see what the end is going to be. So, Lord, today we glorify you. We praise you. We lift you up. We give your name the honor, the praise, and the glory. For you are a great God and worthy to be praised. And so right now, dear Lord, we thank you that we stand on the brink of a breakthrough. Now, bless this service. And when we leave from this place, we'll tell a dying world that you still live because you live here at Wilberforce University. Hallelujah, thy the glory. Hallelujah. Amen.
President Flake, Chancellor of the Wilberforce Board, this is Dr. Tom Lester, Bishop Richard Allen Hildebrand, Bishop Ashkai McKenzie, to Mrs. Nancy P. Stokes, beloved former First Lady of Wilberforce and retired Episcopal Supervisor, Mr. Stanley McKenzie, Episcopal Supervisor of the 18th District of our church, to the officers and members of the Board of Trustees University, to the people of Allen who have come to help us to invest with the office of President of Wilberforce, your pastor, your leader, and our great friend. Mr. Richard Lewis, the then General Treasurer of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, President Emeritus Yvonne Walker Taylor, to the members of the Flake family, and to all of you from Allen who have come to be with us today, to clergy who are in attendance, to distinguished guests and delegates from other institutions of higher learning and societies of learned people. We greet you this day in a day of joy that we've come to invest with the presidency of Wilberforce, one of her own sons, Floyd H. Flake. I think I ought to explain to you how I happen to be here. They looked around for someone who looked old enough to be everybody's dad. And the way they did it, they, I think, did something about the number 3. I graduated from Wilberforce in 1943. And it took 3 presidents to get that class out of the school. 3 decades later, in 1973, I was elected to the Board of Trustees of the University. And during that time on the board, I have served on 3 presidential search committees. keep us safe and give us God. Now if I took all those seeds of the many powers which are identified there, the total number would be something like 17 or 18,000. And I believe that's how I happen to be standing here invested with the order of patriarchy to stand before you. And embedded in that order of patriarchy is the privilege of extending hospitality of the family to guests and visitors. I therefore am here, on behalf of my fellow members of the Board of Trustees of this university, to welcome you, to say how glad we are that you came, to tell you that your presence does much to enhance this occasion in our minds. It will long be remembered, the mark of your respect and affection for Dr. Flake. You know, there is a commercial for a chain of restaurants that says, when you're here, you're family. And that's the way we look at you today. You're here, you're family. The most important work that a Board of Trustees of any university has, I believe, is the selection of a president and chief executive officer to take care of the affairs and that institution. We accept humbly as we can, with all becoming humility and modesty, your congratulations upon the fine work which we have done in selecting presidents of this institution in the past, and certainly in the present instance as we have used the vernacular of the streets at the jackpot with our president who leads us from this point. We don't just inaugurate a president of Wilberforce. We don't just install a president of Wilberforce. We invest him with the future of this institution. We invest him with our faith and our trust, and place in him our full confidence that he will lead us to higher heights, that he will lead us to a future that is waiting to be born. On that note, we thank you for your participation in this service. There's another expression that I hope you will find acceptable, and it's this. Today, I am a Wilberforce. And that is the attitude that we hope that you have. Welcome particularly to my best friends and students of this institution, as well as their distinguished faculty, administrative officers, and all of the staff. Welcome to one and all. God bless you. Thank you for coming.
Greatly esteemed to be formally installed as the 18th president of Wilberforce. protocol being already established. Angels of redemption, members of the household of faith, citizens of the Commonwealth of Heaven, and to all of those who have gathered here for this investiture service, has there ever been a time in your life you felt rejection? Has there ever been a time in your life you've had no sunshine but rain now? Has there ever been a time in your life you've had intensified pain of losing a loved one, pain of someone stabbing you in the back, pain? Truly, if it was left up for justice today, we would all be dead and gone. But I believe Nas wrote, I know I can. And if I work hard at it, I'll be where I want to be. And that's good. But the writer writes in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things. In spite of the pain slip on the job, in spite of what's going on with our financial aid, in spite of what's going on the campus, all things through Christ, which strengthens us. I believe it was Dr. King who said there are two types of leaders. There are thermometer leaders, and there are thermostat leaders. A thermometer judges the temperature, but a thermostat leader changes the temperature. Our president is committed to uplifting Wilberforceans. The mandate of excellence is prevalent throughout his entire administrative team. The Student Government Association has also risen the bar along with our president for student leadership, and we stand with our president and support the Capital Campaign Program. I would at this time that the board for the Student Government Association please stand. Student Government Association board members. We, the Student Government Association, present a check of $500 toward the Capital Campaign Program of our university. Wilberforce shall not die, but it shall live. With his blood, he has saved us. With his power, he has raised us. To God be the glory.
As far as Parkinson and my good friend on the faculty, I feel I should just say thank you, Jesus, and sit down. Mr. Hildebrandt, Mr. Webster, Mr. McKenzie, Reverend Floyd Flake, Reverend Elena Flake, faculty, members of the faculty, members of the trustee board, students, fellow Wilberforceans and friends. It is my distinct pleasure to bring you greetings from the Wilberforce University Alumni Association. We, the alumni, are very proud and pleased to welcome a fellow alumnus, the Reverend Dr. Floyd Flake, class of 68, as the 18th president of our university. And we want to assure you, Reverend Flake, that the members of the Alumni Association stand behind you, beside you, and if need be, in front of you. In full support, as you assume what you have stated was the daunting challenge of riding the great ship of Wilberforce University. On Wednesday evening, the choir sang a piece called The Impossible Dream. We, the alumni, feel, Reverend Flake, that you represent the possible dream. Our dream of a vibrant, in a
dignitaries, and Christians all. It is my pleasure today to introduce the first family of Wilberforce University. Dr. Floyd Flake is a family man with an outstanding wife and four offspring, two daughters, two sons, and granddaughter, Leah. Will Aaliyah, Mariana, and Mayla Lorise please stand? Now, will Robert Rashad and Harold Hassan stand? Let us see Nia. Margaret Elaine McCollum Flake has distinguished herself as a preacher, teacher, effective lady in Christian education, and evangelistic outreach ministry. Dr. Flake is an itinerant elder in the African Methodist Episcopal Church and currently serves as a co-pastor of the Allen AME Church, Jamaica, New York. She is also the educational director of the Allen Christian School, which she co-founded with her husband and senior pastor, the Reverend Dr. Floyd H. Flake. Established in 1983, the school currently has an enrollment of 450 African American students and provides a quality education for the young people in grades 3K through 8. After completing her childhood education in Memphis, her native home, Dr. Flake earned the Bachelor of Arts degree in English from Fisk University in Nashville, Tennessee. She received a Master of Arts degree in English from Boston University and the Master of Divinity degree from Union Theological Seminary in New York City. She was awarded the Doctor of Ministry degree from United Theological Seminary, Dayton, Ohio. The recipient of numerous citations and awards, she is a member of the Alpha Kappa Alpha sorority. Reverend Elaine, as the Allen family knows her, has been instrumental in the founding of Allen Women's Resource Center, Allen Prison Ministry, and other ministries that serve the church and the Jamaica community. She serves as advisor to the missionary department and as advisor coordinator of the Allen Women's Ministry Department. She hosts yearly retreats which are attended by over 1,000 women from across the country and the Caribbean. Dr. Flake has contributed to articles in the Women of Color Study Bible and in the book Souls of My Sisters, Black Women Break Their Silence, Tell Their Stories, and Heal Their Spirits. She recently authored her own book, God in Her Midst. She and Floyd are authoring a book titled Practical Virtue, Everyday Values for the African American Family, which is slated for release this year by HarperCollins. Ladies and gentlemen, I acknowledge and introduce to you Dr. Margaret Elaine McCollins Flake.
Thank you. Tim Zink, certainly the supervisor of standing with Tim Zink, president of the Alumni Association, Colonel Leakey, Sister Nancy Stoke, two volunteer of the dignitaries, the faculty of the Supermark, and especially two trustees of the Wilberforce University. The last time I made a presentation, somebody informed me after it was over that I was stupid for standing there, reading a whole lot of stuff, and it's already printed in the book. And I said I wouldn't make that mistake again. You can look in the book and see that he is a trained individual. He went to the best seminary there is on planet Earth. You can definitely see that he has been a successful pastor. The churches where he has gone are recorded in the booklet. You can look and see that he became a bishop in 1972 and the places where he served. But there are some things that are not in there, which explains why he's such a successful person. And it is only right that he would be here today, because he was the one who sent Dr. Flake to Allen, Jamaica. I think the biggest job a bishop had is trying to match parishioner and pastor, and he is a master at that. I looked at this crowd the other day and I said, you know, Floyd Flake has a lot of sense. He didn't know whether it'd be a crowd, though, but he brought his own crowd. And that's why he's the president of Wilberforce University. He has a lot of sense. Bishop Hildebrand certainly is kind of person to come and give a charge, give a challenge. If anybody knows Floyd Flake, he does. If anybody knows of his work, if anybody knows of his pastoral ability, Bishop Hildebrand does. So today, we have selected the right person to give a charge to the individual who will take this institution on the higher heights. Came in, everybody was happy, everybody was joyous, everybody was elated, and they had a right to be. Because I've seen some changes take place on this campus. So I want you to know that I'm proud of what I have seen. Did not record that he is a man of integrity. Does it record that he deals in right action? It doesn't record. It doesn't record that he is a compassionate individual. The book does not say that he loves people. And that's why he has gone as far as he has. So today, I want you to read what's recorded here about this people. I want our young people to look at it, analyze it. What individual do you have here today? Has made great strides in the field of education, in the field of ministry. I ask you to listen to them, because certainly we have been a mentor for many bishops. We are elected one day, we become a bishop the next day, and we don't, sometimes we don't have enough training as we should, but we have mentors. Thanks be to God today that Richard Allen Hildebrand has been a mentor for many of us who did not know the way, many of us who were coming in the dark. But I want you to know that he showed us the way. So we come today in the history. Bishop, successful pastor, civil rights leader. We come today to listen to you, an individual who will give a charge to the president, who will take this institution on the higher heights. Before the choir sings, I ask that you do me a favor. I ask that you stand and give the speaker hand as he comes before us after the rendition by this choir. Will you stand, please? Give Richard Dillon Brand a big hand.
Oh.
Bishop Robert P. Webster, Bishop McKenzie, and your spouses, including my own beautiful wife back there, and to Dr. Flake, the president of Wilberforce. And to his dear wife, the Reverend Dr. Margaret Elaine Flake. In her own right. And to, I'm just going to say, the Wilberforce family. Including Dr. Yvonne Walker Taylor and Mrs. Nancy Stokes. Everybody, Wilberforce family. All those people, Dr. Cannon mentioned, everybody, my sisters and my brothers, in Christ Jesus, our Lord. This is a marvelous occasion, and I want to thank the committee, the Investiture Committee, for allowing me to have a part in this great occasion. I just want to commend the Allen Church from Jamaica, New York. For coming in such large numbers and participating so graciously in this, what I call, a worship service. And I want you to know they do this every Sunday, three times, at Allen Church. All of this pageantry, this sacred pageantry that you witness here, they do that at 6:30 in the morning when thousands of people are present, and again at 8:30 in the morning, and again at 11:30 in the morning. I've never seen it on this border. Whenever I go, it almost frightens me. But it is something to behold. And this is the kind of man who leads this congregation, this leading Wilberforce at this time. And I'm so glad he was selected. I just want to salute the other living presidents, former presidents, Dr. Taylor, Charles Taylor, who is now the president of Morris Brown College in Atlanta, Georgia. And our own Miss Wilberforce, if you want to say that, Dr. Yvonne Walker Taylor. She truly represents Wilberforce, the first female president ever elected. And we thank our immediate past president, Dr. John Henderson, for his tremendous service. The committee's letter asked me to preach. This is an academic occasion, but they say preach the investiture sermon. The folder says investiture message. Well, I don't know how to do anything but preach anyhow. So you can call it anything you want. But I want to take a text from the
Gospel of St. Matthew, the 9th chapter, the 37th and 38th verses. And Jesus said to his disciples, "The harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are so few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth more laborers into his harvest." Looking for people to help other people. Jesus was looking for more laborers to help other people. This 9th chapter of Matthew is replete with instances in which Jesus was helping people. It is said that he went about doing good. He helped someone who was blind, gave him back his sight. A lady had an issue of blood, he cured it. A little girl was in a coma, he woke her up. He helped a number of people, but as he helped people, he was criticized, severely criticized. The Pharisees said, "He is not Son of God. He doesn't even represent God. He represents the devil, and all of this stuff he's doing is witchcraft." Yeah, but he continued to work the work with him who sent him. And I think everyone who leads must be prepared for criticism and ridicule. It's going to come. If you haven't experienced it yet, just wait a little while. It's on its way. But you have to keep pressing in the name of the Lord. Jesus was moved by the people who came to him looking for help. And he looked around and said, "Oh, it's so pitiful that there are so many people who need help. They're like sheep without a shepherd. No one to help them. No one to meet their needs. Sheep without a shepherd." Not that there were no one, there was no one there who was supposed to be shepherding. Old man Annas, the retired emeritus high priest was there, Caiaphas was there, subordinate priests were there, and the scribes were there, and the Pharisees were there. But they might as well not have been there. I wonder if you who are leaders are so meaningless to the people you are trying to lead and help that you might as well not be there. I used to have some pastors like that. The church has got along better without them. And sheep without the shepherd. The harvest is plenteous. The laborers are so few. Send you ask, you pray to the Lord of the harvest that he will find somebody to help these people. And I think our world today, there's so many people who need a lot of help. Oh, God gave us a most beautiful planet. There's enough for everybody. Enough land for everybody. Enough food for everybody. Enough clothing for everybody. Why can't everybody just live together in happiness? I'll never understand why we have to go to war. I am a peace.
this. He wants us to have happiness and peace and joy. Why do we have to send our young men and women in their prime to kill and be killed? Something wrong. The harvest is plenteous. The laborers are so few. Let us pray God Almighty that He will send forth this more laborers into His harvest. When you think of our people, our pastor and, well, I live now, I was pastor. The bishop took my church, so I gave it to him. After retiring from the bishopric, I went to a little city that needed a pastor. The bishop allowed me to pastor, and I really enjoyed it. But I have to remember, I'm not pastoring anymore. But in that little town where I used to pastor, in that county, Nassau County, about 20% of the citizens are African Americans, but the jail population, the male jail population, 94% African American. Our black men, young men, older men, in jail. Women looking for husbands and they're in jail. It's a pity, something's wrong. And those of us who have the opportunity to go to college and to the seminary, we are supposed to be leaders, and we got to have the faith to believe that God will guide us and help us to stand on our feet and be leaders. If we don't help our people, who's going to help them? The harvest is hideous. The laborers are so few. Our youngsters won't stay in school. They take up with drugs. The girls get pregnant, they fall out, they've lost hope. Who's to help them but us? God gave you the opportunity to go to school and get an education and get a good job. It's your duty, your responsibility to reach out and help somebody along the way. We've got to rise, we've got to go, and we can do better than we're doing. The first person we've got to start helping is ourselves. If you haven't read Dr. Flake's book, The Way of the Bootstrapper, it's out there on the table. Before you leave, you buy one. You need to read it. How a person can lift him or herself. And if he has the guts and the desire and faith in God, you can be anything in this world you want to be. You have to believe in yourself. If you don't believe in yourself, how can you help anybody else? Just have faith and press on and trust God, and He will bring you out both as conqueror, and then you can reach out and help somebody else. The harvest is plenteous, the laborers are few, and we're looking for people to help other people. I guarantee you that if you help somebody else along the way, you will find true happiness and true peace. Oh, I know most of us, once we get our education, we figure we ought to make it for ourselves, and that's all right. You need to make it for yourself. You need some money. Don't believe it if those of us who are so religious say you don't need any money. All you need is Jesus. If you don't have any money, I don't believe you have Jesus. You need to make getting all the money that you can, but don't let that be your main aim, just to make it by yourself and let the world go by. We have a responsibility. So get your job. Rise as high as you can. Go on up the ladder. But remember your brother who's beneath you. Too many of us fall through the cracks. Let us let God use us to his honor and glory by helping others. Help yourself. You can be what you want to be, believe me. And you have someone now in the students of Wilberforce who will help you, who is himself a bootstrapper. And he will show you and teach you and lead you into how to be the very best person that you can be. A man of excellence. I think all of us ought to reach for excellence. While pastoring a young lady came to me crying the blues, she said on her job, she can't get promoted. You have to have a college degree in order to get promoted on her job if you're black. All of the other white people are promoted, but she can't get promoted because she doesn't have a college degree. And I said to her, well, stop crying and go on and get your college degree. Nothing wrong, I know it's unfair, but there's nothing wrong with being excellent. Don't satisfy yourself with mediocrity. Don't settle for mediocrity. Reach to the highest. Reach to the highest. Anytime you don't become all that God intended for you to be, all that he gave you the capacity to become, then you frustrate the works of God. You've got to be all that you can be in this world in order to help others. And then we got to help our institutions to be all that they can be. We got to help our churches. God knows that the black people came as far as we have come through the church. The road has been rough and the going has been tough. And the hills have been hard to climb, but we come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord. And I just don't believe he brought us this far to lead us, to leave us. So let's go on working with the church, strengthen the church, establish the church. All of us may not be like Alan Jamaica, but we can be all that God has given us the capacity to become in our churches. Strengthen your church. Don't you let God's hand alone. You hold on to it. Hold on to God's unchanging hand. That's how we got here. The choir sang, "When tonight ain't gonna lay my legion down." Don't you lay your legion down. Your legion brought you thus far. Let us hold on to God's hand. Develop our institution. Wilberforce has such a glorious history. Wilberforce. There's something mystical about Wilberforce. Just to tread on these grounds, it seems that something oozes up from the ground itself to embody our spirits, our being, with the spirit of Wilberforce. This great institution. I heard a recitation of the president the other night, Wednesday night, and we had some great presidents. I came on board the trustee board under the late Dr. Rembert Stokes, who was one of the greatest presidents this school has ever had. Wilberforce was boomed in, but it was built riddled with strokes that somehow stroked her and nurtured her and loved her and led her and cared for her to heal the school's wounds and bring her back to her former glory. His favorite poem was "The Impossible Dream." He recited it every time he got a chance. He had his impossible dream was to establish the campus on this side of the highway. He had a time trying to get the rest of us trustees to see his dream. He thought it was impossible to come to move the campus from over there, over here. But God sent a party and tore down the building and tore up the ground. Nothing else to do but to come over here and realize here we are. There were some alumni who said, "No, we can't leave this campus for the year. We've got to stay here, renovate the buildings, and do whatever you must, because the fountain is here. We can't leave our fountain." The fountain was the meeting place for lovers. Many of them had their first kiss around the fountain. On commencement day, several of them would get married around the fountain. We can't leave our fountain. Brim Stokes, as ingenious and imaginative as he was, said, "We'll have a lap. We'll get the engineers to uproot the fountain and bring it across the highway." And here we still have our fountain, one of the beautiful symbols of Wilberforce. He was a graduate of fame who came home to heal the wounds of his alma mater. We had another graduate, Yvonne Walker Taylor, who served so well as the first female president of this school. The harvest is plenteous. The laborers are few. We're looking for people to help other people. While looking, we found Floyd Flake, another graduate of Wilberforce. And we are going to follow his leadership. You know, I know you, Floyd. I can say, like Paul said of Timothy, "I know you, I know your works, I know your background." And I believe, just like God, through me, sent you to Allen Church to make of it a great religious social enterprise. I believe God, in his divine wisdom, arrange for you to come to Wilberforce to be our president. I know it's kind of rough to pastor Allen Church and be president at Wilberforce. I know that, but you are a congressman and you travel from New York to Washington, it's not that much difference. in New York to Dayton. And then you are one of God's extraordinary persons. I know you. I know your ability. I know how God touches everything you put your hand to and make it successful. I know you. I know you. You are here by God's commission, and you have at your side a wonderful wife, herself talented, both of you multi-talented. Elaine, you might as well get with it. This is God's will. Hallelujah. God's will to meet the people, to help of the people. We got to help our black people. Help these young people to have hope, to have faith, to hold on, and help us rise higher and higher and higher. We have a long ways to go in this country so filled with racism. We cannot allow racism to get us down. We got to learn how to talk with it and keep on rising anyhow. We need you. God gave us you. And we are here for the duration. We're not wasting all of these wonderful, beautiful, investiture ceremonies on a temporary situation. Carry us both, Wilberforce and Allen Church. And I want to challenge you to lead us forth under God's banner. Lead us forth until the nations of this world become the kingdoms of our God in His might. And He shall reign forever and ever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
members of the Board of Trustees please stand?
Presentation of the Medallion of Office. The Wilberforce University Medallion of Office is handed down from person to person, gaining meaning and significance from the students. With this medallion, we hand down 147 years of history. This medallion represents how far we have come and reminds us of how far we yet have to go. The President.
Chairman, members of the Board of Trustees, I receive this medallion, mindful of the responsibilities and trust that is encouraged within accepting it by the help of God Almighty. Thank you.
And if I repeat this pledge of commitment, everyone in unison, please stand. We personally cherish the unique history of Wilberforce University. Because we know the enormity of your task. We pray ourselves to sit in the leadership of our next. We will not cease to pray for you and those who lie to be affected, style, and character of your mission. God, strengthen your heart, mind, soul, and body.
Thank you very much, Dr. John Walker, members of the Board of Trustees, members of the faculty, members of the administration, to all who have come out to share on this great occasion, and members of this blended hybrid family, which is Wilberforce University at the Great Island Cathedral. I rejoice in the fact that the Lord has put me here for this season, and truly I believe that it is God's season for me in this place. Little could I have imagined that this day would come, a day when I would be president of Wilberforce University. But I accept this responsibility with a great deal of not only fear and trepidation of God's ultimate judgment, but a sense of a reality that without God, it is impossible to do this job. We thank God I do thank God, not only for my wife, but I want to thank God also for my beautiful mother. My mother passed when I was 3 months away from graduating from Wilberforce University, as Brother Wesley and Brother Floyd Alexander know. She wanted so desperately to come, but she had been sick for over a year. But I married into the family and found a mother. So I want you to meet my wonderful mother, Sister Lorene McCollins, Elaine's mother, who is more than a mother to me. Thank you so much, and thank you for coming. And I certainly do want to thank Elaine because over these 28 years, she has had to bear a great deal of burden because of the kind of vision the Lord continually plants, the places that the Lord sends me to. Most of those places have not allowed me to be home on a constant basis, and yet I think she realizes that I've made every attempt to make sure that the time that I am home is quality time. That's why I cook and wash and do all the other stuff I do when I'm home. I want to make sure that she knows that when I'm there, I am there. And so I just want you to stand, honey, and let them know and see my beautiful wife and just a wonderful, wonderful person who never, ever troubles me about what she knows is God's calling and God's purpose, not only for my life, but becomes the purpose of God for both of our lives. And so I want to thank you here and rejoice in the fact that these first 28 years are just the beginning. And as we age together, the day is coming when I'm coming home and I keep on doing all this practice. My sons, Rashid, who most of you around here call Sheed.
And my youngest son, Harold Hassan, who is at Florida A&M, I'm so glad he got in. He got waylaid in Atlanta overnight, but he got here. And I'm just so happy. Also, my grandbaby, Nia, is here. And she is actually the ruler of the family and a member of this choir. Let me thank the choir for coming. This is an overnight journey for them from New York. Some as parents with your children, some who have just taken the journey to be good to you today, and we certainly want to thank and praise the Lord for all of you. My state senator, member of my trustee board at the church, Malcolm Smith, is here, and certainly want to thank Malcolm for coming here, and some church staff members, my CFO, Edward Reed, and my personal executive secretary, director, the other woman in my life who just won't let me rest, Christina London. Many of you know her. She was Bishop Hildebrand's secretary, standing waiting. Just a joy to have you here this morning. Let me just take a moment. Name calling as always gets you in trouble, but I do want to thank the Reverend Rashton McKenzie, who flew in from Africa yesterday. Because as we sit today, the beginning of the Augusta National, the Masters Tournament, and they're talking about whether women can join a club. This is our first woman bishop. I said first woman bishop. In Africa, so the glass ceiling has been broken and broken prayerfully forever. And I want to thank you. I want to thank the lady who was my English teacher. The one who remains from among the names that we all call because we feel in our spirits that without them we could not have made it. We think of Mrs. Askew, we think of Mrs. Jackson, we think of Dr. Wright, Dr. McGinnis, the Valentines, so many. But this lady instilled in us a sense of excellence, and whenever I get up, when I'm around her, I always greet her with the one that I put with the Schiller Sutra, the Truth of March is to the root of the and bathed every vein and squished the kua, so that you might remember that how ingrained Chanterbury's Canterbury Tales. I never could understand why I had to learn it, but she made us learn it, and if you didn't learn it well, you didn't do well. But she ingrained in us certain things. One, she came to class on time, and when she came on time, she locked the door. So if you were not there on time, you did not participate in class, and it was the era where if you had three cuts, you would flunk the class. Secondly, she forced us, even though she was the literature teacher, she took the responsibility of teaching grammar, and she forced us when we spoke incorrectly to speak it until we got it right. And I believe Dr. E.B. Yvonne Walker Taylor, were it not for you, I would not have eloquent speeches on the congressional floor or anywhere else in this world. Stand one more time. We salute you for the ministry. And I say to every faculty member here, several things you can learn from her. First of all, set the standard time. Be demanding. Set the time of class, be there on time, make the students come, and when they don't come, don't give them social promotions, make them earn the grace they get, and they will respect you for the rest of your life. I promise you they will do that. Bishop Hildebrand, I cannot thank you enough. Bishop Hildebrand walked up to me, called me one day out of the blue, and said to me, as I was dean of students at Boston University at the time, "You are the next pastor of Allen Church. I don't know you, but I have met you, and everything about you says you ought to be the pastor. Thank you for such faith, and that faith now brings me to this place to be the president of this university, a place certainly I thought I'd never be president, but looking at the great model that I have in Rembrandt Stokes,
The many parties that I used to serve at the president's house, the many occasions that I had to drive the car for the president when Luther would allow it, and the many times that I've had to serve, and yet look at this beautiful woman raising the children and Rupert Stokes being here for us, a president among students. And I thank you, Nancy Stokes, for being here and sharing this occasion with us as well. Thank you so much. And last but not least, mention Dean Hickey's wife, because in seminary, Dean Hickey's wife, I think she's here, Sister Hickey, she was here, there she is, and I went over to Payne, and I was also at Wilberforce finishing here at the same time. I was also working in the cafeteria. I was also waiting tables at the Biltmore Hotel, and with all of that, they were faithful enough to allow me the privilege of being able to know two wonderful people. Thank you for being here. And let me thank a couple of my fellow students. One, Floyd Alexander. On the days, young people, when I was here, there were only about four students who had cars on this campus. One of those persons was Floyd Alexander. And I want you to know we wore out some Buick Roadmasters during his time here. Floyd, I want to thank you because I know you never thought I'd be up here. To God that you thought enough to drive me around. This brother took me to preach sometimes, had me to preach at churches where he was, took me and fed me. Thank you, preach, because I couldn't have made it without it. I really do appreciate it. And then my goodest friend in college, I was best man at his wedding, drove out to Atlanta when he graduated from ITC. We've been close over the years. We used to have our own table in the cafeteria. Folks would come around us because we were kind of cut up. We kept the enrollment for the chapel. All the students wanted to know us because we kept enrollment reading for chapel. And we ran the movies. We ran the movies on Wednesday nights. We kind of had a little responsibility on this campus. Wesley Reed, pastor of Lee Chapel in Cleveland, Ohio. Thank you, Wesley, for being here this morning. A great friend, a wonderful person. Well, you have a sermon, so let me just conclude with just a few remarks. To the faculty and to the students and to the administrators, as you know, this is a very tough season in Wilberforce's life. It is a tough season, but it is a season that we will get through. All of us realize that God knew what he was doing when he created seasons. There is a winter, but people always look for the spring. And when the spring comes, people complain about the rains, but yet they know that it is a matter of time before the sunshine comes. And they know immediately after the sunshine that the season of harvest, or the fall, or the autumn season is before us. We may be in winter, but God knows I see the season of harvest. We're on our way to another place, and I believe God has willed that it should be so. With these vice presidents, these deans, these division heads, these persons who share in leadership and responsibility here, I believe that God has put us in a place at a time when we can turn the university around. The theme, first, finest, and future. Clearly should be the guiding theme for us as we move forward. We realize that as first, we are the institution that many other colleges and universities emulate. And by emulating us, in many instances, they not only took from us, but they also have surpassed us. We cannot afford the luxury of merely sitting and talking about being the first historically black college or university in the world. It's time for us to start talking about not just being the first, but being the finest. Being the finest means that we must respond to a new set of challenges. We must respond to those challenges in such ways that we decide that we are going to be excellent in every category. Not just talking about being the first historically black African-American college, but being the best university in the world, regardless of what race we happen to represent. Dealing with the reality that this is a much more cultural population than it's ever been, with both the full-time traditional students and those who are part of our non-traditional continuing education population, this is no longer just a black college. This is a university that assumes responsibility for the education of people. And as we do it, there must be three things that we allow to be the definitions for this university. First of all, there must be a level of accountability. And accountability must run throughout the university. not in some departments and lacking in others, but a kind of accountability that is expressed in the fact that when we produce the financial statements of this institution, when those who read them will not be reading them with the cover of color on them. In other words, they will not be saying, this is a black college, therefore we must give them slack. They must receive financial statements like those of any other institution, any other bank, any other financial entity. And when they look at them, they will be able to read them accordingly with an understanding that this is an institution that is worth investing in. Secondly, we must raise the academic flagship, and we must raise it high. We must raise it in such a way that every time a young person graduates from here, they graduate with a sense of excellence, a sense of purpose, a sense of direction, goals in their life, a feeling that God sent them here for a reason, and having received their degree, it is not merely a piece of paper that hangs on a wall, but rather it personifies the essence of the level of education that they have, not only in the sense of what they receive from an academic processing, not only from a theoretical processing, but they are now ready to go out into the world and take on the responsibilities that will help them to be in the positions where they can demonstrate to the rest of the world that it really doesn't matter whether you came from Wilberforce in relationship to the other young people you will encounter from Harvard and MIT and others. What will matter is that you have a sense of purpose about your life, and you say to them, I'm not here because I'm black, I'm not here because I'm from Wilberforce, I'm here because I'm great, I am competent, I am capable, I am excellent, and if you open the door, I will be able to achieve. And thirdly, we must have, as a part of that definition, a redefining of our aesthetics. I am a bit disturbed periodically as I go through this campus. I would invite all of you to come and visit us at the Great Island Cathedral, the 26 or so blocks of various properties that we have. When you go through those blocks, you will recognize an Island property. You will recognize it because the lawns are manicured, not because we're rich, but because I believe aesthetics makes a difference. We must have that same attitude in terms of how we upkeep the buildings, how we upkeep the dorms, the academic facilities. Everything about us must say that we are excellent people because that's the way God made us. And so when you're walking on the campus, if you see paper, pick it up. If you see trash, if you see something that needs to be called into maintenance, call it in. We want to be able to personify the kind of excellence that says we are accountable, that we're academic, that our aesthetics support everything that defines us as an institution. And for those of us who talk about being first and allow ourselves to skip into what we call, what Bishop Jakes calls spiritual necrophilia, let me tell you, I don't believe in worshiping dead things. This institution lives, and it lives through all of us. And if it is going to live to become what God wants it to be, we've got to quit worshiping the dead and deal with the reality that our job is to prepare the living. And as we prepare them for a future that is established by virtue of the fact that within us, we know that we are not the future, because we will spend more time on the other side of eternity than we will spend on this side. So let's get them ready so that they will be able to take from where we leave them, and they will be able to go forward into the future. I'm happy to be here. Never could I have imagined the son of parents, 13 kids, fifth and sixth grade educated, to be able to go through Congress and to be able to come now as president of the university that is my alma mater, where I did not do much more than that of a C student, because I worked about 60 hours a week and I worked hard, praise the Lord. But one thing I learned when I left here was to put together the skills of hard work and the skills of academia and the skills of the things I learned and have a sense of purpose about my life, and God just keeps on lifting me higher and higher. And I just want you to come on and go with me as we go higher and higher and higher. The best days of the world are not over. We just started this journey, and I cannot do it by myself. I need each and every one of you. Let's go higher and let's go higher. And as we go higher, I believe the Lord will give us our just reward. Thank you very much. I'm finished, and I'm looking forward to working with you. several other things that we'd like to do before we close. First of all, the Minister of Dance is Associate Professor of Dance at Hunter College, Kathy Sumler. I don't know Kathy Sumler Turner. And she is over 20 years ago when we started the churchical dance, Bishop Webster, most churches thought we were being rather blasphemous, but many of them have copied us now. And if you have an opportunity, in order for the church to take from the Christmas program where you can see a more full expression. Also, speaking of tapes, there are tapes available for today's service, and Dr. Freeman asked me to make this announcement. They will be available in the foyer following the service, as well as some of my books for those who are interested in how to get your life together, bootstrapping, amen. Lastly, let me just recognize those persons who have come as delegates from other universities. If you're here, would you please stand at this time? We're just so grateful that you spent this afternoon with us. And we hope that participating with us. A number of universities are present, Capital University, Xavier University, Baldwin Wallace College, Urbana University, the College of Worcester, Wilmington College, United Theological Seminary, where Reverend Elaine and I got our earned our doctorates, Tuskegee University, Central State, Dr. Garland was here, he told me he would have to leave early, Bluffton College, Wright State University, and Dr. Dawson from Cedarville was here earlier as well. Let's give all of them a hand and we thank you for sharing with us. With that, let us move toward the conclusion of our service. I think we will be closing out with See What the Lord Has Done. So let's join together now for the Alma Mater, followed by the benediction by Dr. Donald W. Thomas, another classmate who graduated at around the same time that I did. Praise the Lord. Let's all stand and join our hands across the sanctuary, across the gym, wherever we are. I forget, I have these two hats to wear as we sing the University Alma Mater at this time.
Preacher for this hour. And we want to thank you that this is the springtime of year, when tender plants are trying to push their way through the hard black bosom of the earth. God, make us hoes, make us picks, make us rakes, so that we may loosen the ground with our time, our talents, and our resources, that the plants may grow true and strong. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace in your going out and in your coming in your lying down and in your rising up. In the name of the Father who created you, in the name of the Son who saved you, in the name of the Holy Spirit who comforts you. Amen.
Please remain in the places where you are as we make ready for our departure now. See what the Lord has done by Stanley Brown, our director of music, who is the writer of this song.